Welcome to the day 5 of HTTP on programming techniques using Python and MATLAB. So in this session, we will be having two sections. In the first section, we will study the basics of MATLAB. And in the second section, we will study the basics of GUI programming in MATLAB. So what is MATLAB? MATLAB is a programming platform designed specifically for engineers and scientists. So using MATLAB, we can solve different type of mathematical expressions, okay, and we can get the output. So it is mostly suitable for engineers and scientists. The heart of MATLAB is the MATLAB language, a matrix-based language allowing most natural expressions of computational mathematics. So whenever we execute any code or program in this MATLAB software, at that time, the variables that are present in your program or code, those variables are stored in the form of matrix. So that's why it is also called as matrix-based language. Then the full form of MATLAB is Matrix Laboratory. And the company that has developed this software is MathWorks Incorporation. Then other similar softwares are also available. The first one is Mathematica and the second one is Scilab. So this Scilab is mostly similar to MATLAB and it is also open source software. But there are certain limitations of Scilab. The inbuilt functions that are available in Scilab are very much limited and the toolboxes are also limited. The other disadvantage is that the support, online support is also very less as compared to MATLAB. So in this session, we will be using MATLAB. So now we'll cover some MATLAB basics. So whenever we write any code or program in MATLAB, that code or program can be saved with an extension of .m. Okay. And it is a text-based code. So we have to write the program and we can save it with an extension of .m. Then another type of programming is also available in MATLAB, which is graphical based platform. Okay, this graphical based platform is available in Simulink, which is again part of MATLAB. So in that Simulink, we can develop any system with the help of blocks that are available in Simulink. We can interconnect those blocks according to the logic and we can simulate the system. Okay, so that is a graphical and platform. Okay. And while saving the files of that Simulink software, we have to use the extension as .mdl. Then the default layout of MATLAB is going to have certain windows. So out of them, first one is the command window. Okay. So the command window is used for executing a command and displaying the output of that command. Okay, so one command can be executed at a time and we can immediately get the output of that command. Then the next one is the command history. So whenever we open the software and we enter or execute some commands, so if you want to check the previous executed commands, those commands can be seen in this command history. Then the next window is workspace. So whenever we execute any code, some variables are generated. Those variables are available or those are visible in this workspace window. So whenever any variable is there, that details about that variable are also displayed in that workspace. For example, the data type of the variable, the dimensions of the variable, the minimum value or the maximum value of that variable, all these things are displayed in the workspace window. Then the next one is editor. So this editor window is the window where we can type our program. And we also have Simulink, so which is a graphical platform for developing any system and simulating it. So all these things we'll again see when I open the software. Okay. So what we'll do at the end of every slide, I will switch over to the software and I will show you the details that we have discussed. Then next one is commenting the code. Now, whenever we write any program, it is very important to write a comment for most of the statements. Okay, because whenever someone else is going to go through your code, that person will not be able to understand your code because you have written that code as per your logic. So to make that code readable, we have to write comments, right? So to write comment in MATLAB, we have to use percentage symbol. So when we type percentage symbol and when we type anything after that, that will be considered as a comment and it will be displayed in green color. Then next one is the use of semicolon at the end. So this semicolon is used at the end for terminating the statement. So even if we don't give the semicolon at the end, still the program will work without any problem. Okay. So the difference is that if we don't give semicolon at the end of the statement, then whatever output or result is there for that statement, that will get displayed in the command window. And if we give a semicolon at the end of the statement, then that statement will get executed, but the result will not be displayed in the command window. That is the only difference. Then MATLAB is case sensitive. Then this is again an important thing, that whenever we define any variable name, okay, that name is case sensitive. Suppose if we have given some name with M as capital and the remaining things in small case, then in that case, every time whenever you want to use that variable, you have to use the same format, that is M capital and other letters in small case. If I use all the letters in small case, it will consider it as a new variable. So that's why we have to be careful while using the variable names, because it is case sensitive. Now I will switch over to the MATLAB software and we'll see all the things that we have discussed just now. So this is the layout of MATLAB when you open it. So here there are different windows. So this is the first window, that is the command window. Here we can type any command and we'll get the output of that command in the same window, right? Then here we are having this workspace window. Here whatever variables are present in your program, all those variables will be displayed, right? The value of those variables, the class of those variables can also be displayed in this workspace, right? If you want other parameters related to that workspace, those parameters can also be added. So you have to just right click here and you can select any of these parameters. So if, for example, if I select size, I will get the size or the dimensions of the variable. Then to write the program, we can go to this new script. So when once I click on that new script, another window will open here. You can see here editor. So using this editor, we can type our program. So this is the default layout of MATLAB. So if I want to write a comment, I can simply use percentage symbol and I can type the comment over here. For example, this is the beginning of the code. Okay. So with this, I can enter any statement or comment in my code. Now I will type some commands over here, okay, in the command window. For example, a is equal to 3. Okay. And now I have not given semicolon at the end. And if I hit enter, I will get the result as a is equal to 3 and a variable named a is created. So in this workspace, the details about that variables are displayed. So a is a variable which is having value 3, the size is 1/1 and the class is double. So all the things related to that variable are displayed in the workspace. Now I will do the same thing, but now here I will have some other value, for example 6, and I will now give a semicolon. Okay. So now if I hit enter, the result is not displayed. It was displayed in the previous case. So whenever I terminate any statement with a semicolon, the result is not displayed in the command window. But you can see that the variable is updated with the new value. So a is now equal to 6. Now, if I want to check the previous commands that I have executed, I can simply click or hit the upward arrow on the keyboard. So all the commands that I have executed previously are available or visible over here. That is nothing but our command history. Now here, if I want to check the value present in any variable, I can simply type the name of that variable, for example A, and hit enter. So I will get the value that is present in that variable. Now, as I said, MATLAB is case sensitive, so small a and capital A will be treated as different variables. So here you can see now two different variables are there, A and capital A, and both are having different values. Okay. So while deciding on variable names, we have to decide those carefully because MATLAB is case sensitive. The next is some basic commands for clearing the contents. Okay. So first one is close all. Now this close all command is used whenever we want to close all the windows except the main window. Okay. So generally whenever we want to display image or some figures, those are displayed in a separate window. And whenever we want to close all those open windows except the main window, we have to use this command close all. The next is clear variable underscore name. So here the variables that are created in workspace can be deleted or cleared using this clear command. So I have to type the command as clear and the name of variable that I want to delete. The next one is clear all. So this clear all clears all the available variables in the workspace. And finally, we have CLC, which is used for clearing the contents that are displayed in the command window. Okay. So we'll see the execution in this software. So now let us say I want to clear the variable capital A. So I can type the command as clear A. Okay. So you can see here in the workspace it is available, but when I execute this command, that gets deleted. Okay. Similarly, if I want to clear all the available variables in the workspace, then I can use the command as clear all. Okay. So it will clear all the variables that are present in the workspace. Now here you can see in the command window, different results are displayed. Now if I want to clear these results, then I can type CLC and hit enter. So all these commands that are the results that were displayed in the command window will get cleared. Okay. Then next one is defining variables. So as I said, the MATLAB uses different variables and all those variables are stored in workspace. So here the first variable that is declared is x1 is equal to 3.4 and semicolon. After that x2 is equal to -2 and semicolon. So this will create two different variables having the name as x1 and x2, and the value stored in x1 will be 3.4 and the value stored in x2 will be -2. Okay. Then default variable type is double. So whenever any variable is created, it is going to have class as double. If you want to convert any variable from one class to another class, then again different keywords are present. So to convert a variable type to integer, we can use this class as int32. So x1 we have declared over here, which is going to have the variable type as double. But now if I use this statement as y1 is equal to int32 x1, so this will convert this x1 data type into integer of 32 bits and it will be stored in y1. So the original data type of x1 will remain as it is, that is double, but the number that is going to be stored in this y1 variable is now going to have the data type as int32. So it will be an integer of 32 bits. Similarly, if I execute this y2 is equal to uint8 and x2, this will convert this x2 into an unsigned integer of 8 bits. Okay. Now x2 is having value -2, which is a negative number, but this data type is unsigned integer. So this x2 will be simply made equal to 0 and it will be stored in y2. So original value of x2 will remain as it is, but the value that will be stored in y2 will be 0. In this case, the y1 is equal to int32 x1. The number, that is 3.4, will be converted into an integer value and it will be stored in Y1. Okay. Then other data types are double, single, INT8, 16, 32, 64. Similarly, UINT8, 16, 32, and 64. Now we'll see the demonstration of this in MATLAB. So I will type here, let's say X1 equal to 3.4. Right? So you can see the data type of that variable is double. Okay. Then X2 equal to, let's say, minus 2. Here also you can see the data type is double. Right? Now if I convert that data type using this statement as Y1 is equal to INT 32 X1. Okay. Now what will happen? That Y1, that X1 will get converted into Y1. Okay. And that Y1 is going to have format or the class as 32, INT 32. Okay. And the number also you can see here, it is 3. Previously the value in X1 was 3.4, but now it is a integer value, which is 3. Okay. Similarly, the next one is, let's say Y2 is equal to UINT 8 and X2. So here I will get value as 0 because the original number in X2 is a negative number and I have used here a data type as unsigned integer. Okay, so since the original number was having negative sign, it is now converted into 0 and then it is stored in Y2. So again, you can see here the original value in X1 and X2 remains as it is. That value is not changed. Then the next is defining vectors. So here we can define different type of vectors or matrices in MATLAB. So first one is Y1 is equal to in square brackets 1 semicolon 2 semicolon 3. So with this we can create a column vector. Okay, whenever we give semicolon in square brackets, at that time the element that is after that semicolon will be stored in the next row. So this is the first element, 1 semicolon is given, that's why 2 will be saved in the second row and 3 will be saved in the third row. Okay, then Y2 is equal to square brackets minus 1 space 0 space 1 and here a single inverted quote is given. So it means that this is also going to create a column vector because this single inverted quote indicates transpose. Okay, so this is actually a row vector, but since we have written here a single inverted quote, it will be transposed and then it will be stored in Y2. So we can define special vectors. So once is a function which creates a matrix which is having all elements as 1, and we can also define the size or the dimensions of that matrix. Similarly, we also have zeros function which creates a matrix with all elements as 0 and the dimensions of the matrix will be as specified in the function. Then with this we can define index vectors. Okay, so index vectors are again going to have sequential entries or elements inside them. So here I is equal to 1 colon 10 will create an array of 10 elements. Starting element will be 1 and final element will be having value as 10. Okay, and the in between values will be having a difference of 1. So the default difference is always 1. Then here one more example is there, j is equal to minus 1 colon 0.5 colon 4. So this is also going to create an index vector. Here again the starting element will be having value as minus 1 and the final element is going to have the value as 4 and the values will have a difference of 0.5. Okay. So now let's see this in software. So Y1 is equal to, let's say, 1 semicolon 2 semicolon 3. So I have not given semicolon after that square bracket. If I hit enter, you'll get the result as Y1 is equal to 1, 2 and 3. So it is a column vector. So also here you can see Y1, it is having size as 3 by 1. So 3 rows are there and 1 column is there. Okay. Then Y2 is equal to, let's say, minus 1 space 0 space 1. Okay. If I give a single inverted quote at the outside of the square bracket, then again it will create a column vector which is having the elements as minus 1, 0 and 1. Again, you can see here the dimensions as 3 by 1. But now if I want to execute the same command, I can simply hit the upward arrow and I will get to that command statement. Now I will remove that single inverted quote, that is the transpose of the statement. And if I hit enter, you will see that y2 is now a row vector which is having the same elements, that is minus 1, 0 and 1. So here the dimensions or the size of that matrix is 1 by 3. Next is we can create index vectors, right? So for that I can have some variable like I equal to 1 colon 10. Okay. So with this, it will create an array of 10 elements having the starting element value as 1 and final element value as 10. Okay. And all the intermediate values are having a default difference of 1. Okay. Let me take another variable, j is equal to minus 1 colon 0.5 colon 4. Okay. Now with this, what will happen? Again, it will create an array which is going to have starting value as minus 1 and final value as 4. But now here I have specified the difference that I require between the intermediate values. So here the difference specified is 0.5. So when I hit enter, it will generate an index vector having values with the difference of 0.5. Okay, so first value is minus 1, final value is 4, and all the intermediate values are having a difference of 0.5. Now if I want to create special vectors like matrix of all elements as 1 or matrix of all elements of as 0, then I can use the function as zeros and ones. Okay, so let us say a is equal to ones, and in brackets I have to write the dimensions of that matrix. So let us say 2 comma 3. So it means that I want to create a matrix A which is going to have all elements as 1 and which is going to have number of rows as 2 and number of columns as 3. So if I hit enter, I will get a matrix with all ones, right? Similarly, I can have a matrix with all zeros using the function as zeros. And again, let us say 3 comma 2. So this will create a matrix B with all elements as 0 and having 3 rows and 2 columns. Okay, so this is the B matrix. So this is how we can create some special arrays. Then next is defining arrays. So if you want to define any array, okay, so we can define it in this way. That is, for example, A is equal to inside square brackets 1 space 0 space 1 semicolon 0 space 3 space 0 semicolon 0 space 0 space minus 1, and after this square bracket we have given a semicolon. So semicolon indicates that it is termination of the statement, but this, whenever I execute this statement, it will not display the result in the command window. So this will create a matrix A which is having 3 rows and 3 columns. So first row is going to have 1 0 0, second row is going to have 0 3 0, and third row is going to have 0 0 minus 1. Okay. Then next is defining diagonal arrays. So here we can have a diagonal matrix having the diagonal elements as specified in that function. So for the command that we have to use is diagonal, that is DIAG, and inside round brackets we have to again specify the values, diagonal values inside square brackets. Okay, so these are the values 1 2 minus 4. So only these diagonal values will be present and all other remaining values in that matrix will be 0. The next one is defining identity matrix. So again, an inbuilt function is present to create a identity matrix. So the function is I, EYE. So with this, I can create an identity matrix of 3 by 3 dimensions. So here 3 is written, that's why 3 rows and 3 columns will be there and all the diagonal elements will be 1. Okay. Similarly, we can also have another matrix as A3 is equal to I, 5 comma 4. So again, this will be a matrix having 5 rows and 4 columns and all the diagonal elements will be identity or 1. Okay. So now let us see the demonstration of this. So let us say A is equal to, I want to define some matrix 1 space 2 space 3 semicolon 4 space 5 space 6 semicolon 7 space 8 space 9. Okay, now if I hit enter, it will create a matrix. Okay, now if I want to create a diagonal matrix, then I can have, let's say A1 is equal to DIAG. This is the command. Inside round brackets, again I have to use square brackets, and I have to specify the diagonal elements. For example, 1 space 2 space 3. Okay, now if I hit enter, it will create a diagonal matrix with the elements specified in the command as 1, 2 and 3, and all elements are 0. Then I can create an identity matrix with the help of again an inbuilt function, as let us say y is equal to EYE, and inside round brackets let's say 3. So it will create a identity matrix of 3 by 3 with all diagonal elements as 1. Similarly, I can also have y1 is equal to, let's say, EYE and 3 comma 4. Okay, so it is going to have 3 rows and 4 columns, and all the diagonal elements will be having value as 1. Okay, and all remaining elements will have value as 0. Next function is magic. So here b equal to magic 4. This indicates that this function will create a matrix B, which will be a square matrix with 4 rows and 4 columns, and the element values of this matrix will be from 1 to 16. So 16 is nothing but the square of 4. So all the elements will be in between 1 to 16. So we'll see the demo of this. So here I will use statement as b is equal to magic 4. So you can see here a matrix of 4 by 4 is created, and the elements are in between 1 to 16. Okay. Then next is basic math operations that we can perform in MATLAB. So among that, first one is x cap 3. So this is nothing but the some variable x will be raised to a power of 3. Okay, so it is nothing but x cube, you can say. Then next one is 2 into y1. So this is again used for multiplying this variable y1 with a scalar constant 2. The next is a into y2. So this can be a variable into variable multiplication, or it can be a, if this a is a matrix and y2 is also a matrix, then it will be a matrix multiplication. Okay. Then a into a will give you the a square value, or the same can be written as a cap 2. Okay. Then next is a cap minus 1. So this will give you the if the variable a is a single scalar, then a cap minus 1 will give you the inverse of that variable. And if it is a matrix, then again all the elements will be having inverted values, inverse values. Okay. Then next is y1 dot star y2. So here this dot indicates it is element by element multiplication. So if y1 is also a matrix and y2 is also a matrix, then the dimensions of these matrices should be same, right? For example, y2 can be a 1 by 2 matrix, y2 can also be a 1 by 2 matrix. Now in this case, the multiplication will be element by element, means first element of y1 will be multiplied with first element of y2, and second element of y1 will be multiplied with second element of y2. That is nothing but element by element multiplication. Then again, we are having some special symbols like pi. So if I type just pi in command window, I will get the value of pi, which is 3.14. Okay, so now we'll see the demonstration of this. So let me define the variable a equal to 3. Okay, and now if I write a cap 3, I will get the cube of, so next is the multiplication of a scalar constant with some variable. Let us say y1 is equal to 4. Okay, and now if I write 2 into y1, it will give me 8. So whatever value is there in y1 will get multiplied by the constant 2. Now let me define another variable y2 equal to, let's say, 3. And now y1 into y2, I will get the value as 12. So y1 was having 4 and y2 was having 3, So the multiplication is 12. Now if I write y1 cap minus 1, this will give me the inverse value of variable y1. So y1 was having value 4, so 1 upon 4 is 0.25. Now here next one is, let us say y1 is equal to 1 space 2, this is one matrix, and y2 equal to 2 space 2, this is another matrix. Now if I write y1 dot star y2, it will perform the element by element multiplication. So you can see here y1 was having 1 and 2 and y2 was having 2 and 2. So this element, that is 1, will get multiplied with this element, that is 2, and this element will get multiplied with this. So the result is 1 into 2 is 2 and 2 into 2 is 4. So we'll have 2 and 4 as the result. This is called as element by element multiplication. And when you want to do that, you just have to include this dot symbol before this multiplication operator. The next one is the special symbol like pi. So if I just type pi and enter, it will give me the value of pi, that is 3.1416. So this can be a special symbol that we can use in MATLAB. The next is accessing vectors or arrays. So here the first one is a:1. So this reads the first column from the matrix or the array A. So this colon indicates all rows and this one indicates first column. So all rows from first column will be read. Then this next is a:1, equal to square brackets 0 space 0 space 2. So this will override the first row of the matrix A to the new values as 0 0 2. So again here this one indicates the first row and this colon indicates all columns of first row. So all this first row will be replaced by these values, that is 0 0 2. Then next is a:1, equal to -1. So this will change the value of the element which is at the position 1, 2 of matrix A to -1. Then next is a:end. This will read the last column of matrix A. It means that this colon means again all rows and :end means the last column of that matrix. So again it will read the last column of the matrix A. So now we'll see the demonstration. So let me define the matrix A as magic 4. So this is a matrix. Now if I want to access the first row of this matrix, then I can use, for example, a:A. I want to access the first row, so I have to write here 1, :. So it will access the first row of that matrix. Similarly, if I want to access this first column of this matrix, then I have to write here, let's say b:a:1. So it will access the first column. Okay. Similarly, if you want to access any in between column or in between row, you can give the command that way. For example, c:a:3. So it will access the third column from the matrix A. Okay. So in that way, we can access the rows or columns from any given matrix. Now next is, I can modify any of the entry in the matrix, right? For example, if I want to change the first row of matrix A, then I can use a:1:. Now here I can specify what values I want to keep in that row. Okay, but just the thing is, your values should match the number of elements in that row. So it is a 4x4 matrix, so I will write here 4 values, that is 0 1 1 0. So now we can see the matrix A has been modified. The first row of A has been modified. Then if I want to access any single element, okay, let's say I want to access this element 12. So that can be done, and I can modify this using again indexing method. Okay, so I have to write here A into brackets, the row number of this element. So this is 1, 2, and 3, third row, and column is 1, 2, 3, 4. So if I write A 3, 4, I will get the value of that element, right? And now if I want to modify that, I can again use it equal to, let's say I want to make it 0, right? So I will get here as 0. Okay, so that is how we can modify individual element from any matrix. And now if I don't know what are the dimensions of any given matrix, then in that case, if I want to find out the last column from that matrix, then I can write, for example, A colon comma end. So this will give me the values that are present in the last column of that matrix. Similarly, if you want to get the values of last row of the matrix, then you can give the command as A end comma colon. So this will give me the values present in the last row of that matrix. So next is again accessing arrays. So A into bracket I comma j will access the ith entry, I comma jth entry of the array or the matrix. Then next is length A. So with this, what will happen? The maximum dimensions either of row or column that will be result of this function. So if I use the function length A, and if A is a 3x4 matrix, then I will get 4 as the result of this function. Then next is R comma C equal to size A. So this size function will give me the dimensions of this matrix, okay, that is specified in this function. Okay, so here the output of this size function is in terms of rows and columns. Okay, so you can have two variables. These will be the output variables for this function. So the first variable will indicate the row, and second variable will indicate the column. Okay. Then appending arrays means if you have already two different arrays, and if you want to append the new values to the end of the first array, then you can use this technique. So x is equal to 1:2:3 is one of the array, and I want to form a new array, that is x1, which will be appended after this x. So the new values appended will be 2, 3, and 5. So x, I have to write it in square brackets, x, again inside the square brackets the value that I want to append, and again I have to complete the square brackets. So this will append the values to the end of the array. So now we'll see the demonstration. So we already have a matrix A. So if I want to find out what is the element of 3, 4 position, then I can simply type A 3, 4. So it will give me the answer as 0, because the element of at 3, 4 is 0. Okay. Now if I use the function length A, I should get 4 as the result. So I'm getting 4 because the maximum both rows as well as columns are same, that is 4. That's why I've got here 4. Okay, let us say now I want to get the dimensions of the matrix. So I can define that in some variables, for example row comma column equal to size of. So here I will get row equal to 4 and column equal to 4. So it will simply give me how many number of rows and how many number of columns are there in the matrix. Now let us define one array A equal to 1 space 2 space 3. Okay. And another array I want to have new values appended to this old array x, right? So again I can have square brackets in the first array, right, space, again I can give the second values in the second array. Let's say 1, 4, 5. Right? So you can see that the new values are appended at the end of the original array x. Okay. So similarly, we can also append the values in a column vector. Okay. So for that, again, I will display x equal to some value. Okay. That is 2, semicolon 4, semicolon 5. Okay. So this is my column vector. Now, if I want to append the values to this column vector, then I can append it. So I can have x1 equal to x semicolon, the new values that I want to append, 5 semicolon, 6 colon, semicolon, 9. Okay. So these values will get appended below the previous column vector. The next is the multidimensional arrays. Okay. So here A. Now next is multidimensional arrays. Now in this case, matrix A is going to have multiple planes. So each plane is going to have some number of rows, some number of columns, and same number of rows and columns will be there in each plane. Okay. For example, here the first one is A into brackets colon comma 1. So this indicates that we are having some rows, some columns, and the first plane, right? So that plane is going to have these values. So this will be the first row, that is 1 minus 1 2, and this will be the second row, that is 0 1 and 3, right? Similarly, with this statement, what I can do, I can add the values to the second plane. Okay, so again, this will be the first row, this will be the second row. Similarly, for third plane also, we can have this as the first row and this as the second row. And now when I write this statement A into brackets 1 comma 2 comma 3, so what this will do, this will access the first row, second column of third plane. Okay, so first row, okay, of third plane and second element. So it is minus 15. So the result of this will be minus 15. Okay, so let us demonstrate this. So we'll have a matrix, for example, D, okay, colon, comma, 1 equal to, I will select a 2 by 2 matrix. So 1 space 2, semicolon 3 space 4. So this is the first plane of D matrix. Now if I want to have a second plane, then again I can give the command as. So I will just replace here 1 by new value as 2, that is second plane, and I can change the values, for example 3, 6. So this is the second plane. Similarly, I can have the third plane as well, or any number of planes that you want. So I will make here the values as 0, 1, 5. So this is the third plane. Now if I have D 1 comma 2 comma 3. So this will access the third plane. Okay. So third plane is this one. Okay. First row and second column of third plane. So first row, second column of third plane. So it will be 2. So the result of this statement will be 2. So that's what I'm getting over here. So here next is the functions to generate some random numbers. So some examples are x is equal to rand 2. So this will create a 2 by 2 matrix, and the numbers or the elements in that matrix will be in the range of 0 to 1. Okay. And these numbers will be randomly generated. Next is q equal to rand 3 comma 2. So this is going to generate a 3 by 2 matrix. Again, all the elements of that matrix will have range from 0 to 1. So the next is z is equal to rand I 5. So this I indicates integer. So using this function, we can generate any random number from 1 to 5, and that will be stored in the variable z. Okay. So now we'll see the demonstration. Here let us say x is equal to rand. So you can see here it has generated a 2 by 2 matrix and all the numbers are between 0 to 1. Next is 2 comma 4, for example. So it will generate a matrix with 2 rows and 4 columns and all the elements will be in between 0 to 1. And the third one is, let's say z equal to rand I 4. So this is going to generate a random integer between 1 to 4 and it is going to store that in the variable z. So here it has generated as 2. So if I again execute that, it has executed given me result as 4, okay, and so on. So in this way we can generate any random number using these inbuilt functions. Then the next is, there are some functions for statistical analysis. Here the first one example is m is equal to mean of y1. So y1 can be any array or it can be a matrix. So if we use this function mean y1, it will find out the mean value of the array or the given matrix, right? So then the other commands that are available for statistical analysis are, first one is min, that is it finds out the minimum value from any given array. Then max is for finding out the maximum value from any given array. Std is the standard deviation. COV is the covariance. Median is there. Then sum of all the elements from that array can be done. And many more such functions are available. Okay, so we'll just see the demonstration for this mean function. So let me define some variable or array e equal to some values 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, and if I use the function mean of e, I'll get the mean as 2.5. similarly, if I use the function sum e, I'll get the sum of the elements of the array e, so that is 10. Okay, so we can have such different type of functions for statistical analysis. The next is the input and display commands. So whenever we want to take some input from user, at that time we can make use of this input command. So we can prompt some message on the command window. So after reading that message, the user can enter a specific value or some input data. And after that, we can get that data in some variable and use it for further processing, right? So here the first thing is v1 is equal to input, enter a value. So this enter a value message will be displayed on the command window whenever this statement is executed. Then here v2 is equal to 2 into v1 into v1. So whatever value the user has entered, that gets stored in this variable v1. So this variable is further used for some processing. So here it is having the expression as 2 into v1 into v1. And now if I want to display the output on the command window, then I can use the inbuilt function called as disp. Okay, so in single inverted quotes, whatever I want to display, I have to write it in single inverted quotes. And again, I can use this disp for displaying the result. Okay, that is v2. Or another method is, I can use display for displaying the message that I want to display. And after that, I can write fprintf and in single inverted quotes, %f slash n and comma v2. So here v2 is the result that we want to display. So using both these techniques, we can display the output in command window. So now let us see the demonstration. So here let me have v1 is equal to input, and I have to type some message in single inverted quotes. For example, enter a value. Okay, so if I click enter, you will see here the message that is displayed is enter a value. So I can enter any value, for example 45. So that 45 will get stored in the variable v1. Okay, now I can use this to perform some operation. For example, let us say v2 is equal to 2 into v1. So now the value is 90. Now I want to display it along with some message. So for that I can use disp in single inverted quotes. I can write 2 into v1 is equal to. Now two ways are there. This is one. After that I can write here again disp and v2. So here I will get the result as 2 into v1 equal to 90, right? Or the other way is I can use the same thing, disp in single inverted quotes. I can write 2 into v1 equal to, and here fprintf again in single inverted quotes, %f slash n for new line, comma the result, that is v2. So if I do that, I will get the result as like this. Then next is the commands for graph plotting. So here what we have done, we have generated a index vector x which is going to have starting value as 0 and final value as 100, and here the intermediate values will be having a difference of 0.1. okay, so this is our x vector. Then here y1 is nothing but sine of 2 pi x by 20. So this is the these values will be present in y1 vector. So the dimensions of x and y will be same. Now I can plot this using the command called as plot, and here I have to give what I want to plot on x axis, and here I have to give what I want to plot on y axis. So x comma y1. So this will plot a graph of the sine wave. Similarly, next is y2 is equal to cos 2 pi x by 20. So here y2 is going to have the cos values or cosine values, and if I want to plot both sine wave as well as cos wave, I can use this command as plot x comma y1 and comma again x comma y2. So this will be the sine wave and this will be the cos wave. Then again I can change the look of the plot by using some additional arguments, like for example plot x comma y1 comma in single inverted quotes g star dash. So this g stands for green color and this star indicates the points in between the plot or in on the plot, and those will be joined with the help of star and this dash symbol. Okay, similarly x2 comma y2 comma single inverted quotes r colon. So this will draw a plot of red color, and the plot is going to have colon as the symbols on the plot. So let us see the demonstration of this. So let's say x equal to 0 colon 0.1 colon 100. Okay, so I will give semicolon. So x variable is created. Then y is equal to sine of 2 into pi into x divided by, let's say, 20. Okay, so this is y variable. Now if I use plot x comma y, I will get here a plot. Okay, so this is the plot that I have generated. Okay, so you can see that is a sine wave. Now starting point is 0 on x axis and final point is 100 on this x axis. Okay. Now if I want to change the or if I want to have a cosine wave as well, so I can have y1 equal to cos 2 into x into 2 into pi into x divided by 20. So this will generate the cos values. Now I can plot x comma y comma x comma y1. Okay, so you can see that here both the waveforms are now generated. So this blue one is the sine waveform and this red one is the cos waveform. Okay, so now again I can change the type of this waveform or plot. So for that I can write the command plot, again same thing, comma. Here inside single inverted quotes I can write g star minus, g star minus, And here I will write in single inverted quotes R colon. So this is the plot that is generated. So you can see that this plot, green color, is again a sine wave which is built with the help of stars. Okay, and the other is the cos waveform, which is built with the help of the colon dots. Okay, so in that way I can change the type of the plot. Next one is supporting commands for graph plotting. So first command is title. So using this title command, we can give title to the figure window or the graph that we have plotted. Then using x label, we can give some name to the x axis, and using y label, we can give some name to the y axis. Then using this grid on command, we can have grid lines in the background of that graph. So there will be grid lines from x axis as well as y axis. So last command is legend. This command is used to give names to the graphs. So for example, if we are having two waveforms in a single plot or figure, in that case, which waveform is having which name, that can be specified using this legend command. So now we'll see the demonstration of this in MATLAB. So now what I will do, I will have a new script file and I will paste the code that we already seen. Okay. And here now I will give the title as in single inverted quotes waveforms. Then here I will give the label to x axis using the command as x label. Again in single inverted quotes, let's say time. And again I can have y label for y axis, let's say amplitude. Then next is I can keep that grid on, and I can give the legend as in single inverted quotes sine, comma, again in single inverted quotes cosine. So now I can run this. So for that I need to save this first of all with some name, let's say temp. Now after that I can run this. So once I run that, I will get this waveform. Now you can see here we have got the title as waveforms to this graph, and on y axis we are having amplitude, on x axis we are having time, and here you can see the legend. So this green color indicates sine wave and red color indicates cosine wave, and you can also see that there are grid lines present in the background. So in this way we can plot different type of graphs in MATLAB. Now if you want to plot the graphs separately instead of in a single window, then you can make use of another command called as subplot. Okay, so subplot here 2, 1, 1. So the meaning of this is that this first letter indicates that how many number of rows you require for that window. Then second argument indicates the number of columns that you need, and the third one indicates the position out of those places where you want to display the figure. Okay, and after that I can use the same command as plot x comma y1. So this will display the waveform in a specific position in that subplot. Then another command is we can have stem y1. So this will have a stem type kind of graph generated in the output. Then another type of graphs that we can have is bar, histogram, or stairs type of graph for displaying the waveforms. Okay. Now we'll see the demonstration of this. So now here, instead of using this plot command, so I can just put a percentage symbol, so that will be commented. Okay, and I don't want to display this all things, so I can again use Control R to comment all the selected statements. Okay. Now here I will use the command subplot. Okay. And I want to have two rows, one column, and in the first position I want to plot the sine wave. So plot x comma y1. Okay. Then I will copy this and again paste this. So here again subplot 2 comma 1, that is two rows and one column will be there in that subplot. And now in the second position I want to display the cosine waveform. So here I will just replace plot x comma y1 by x comma y2. And now if I run this, we will get a subplot which is having a sine wave in the first position and a cos wave in the second position. Now for these waveforms also we can have the same similar kind of naming conventions, that is we can give labels to x-axis, y-axis, we can give title to the figure window and so on. So this is how we can use the subplot command. Next one is stems. So now here instead of plot I will use stem, and if I run that I get such kind of waveform. So here if I zoom this, you can see that these waveform is formed with the help of vertical stem lines, right, like this. Okay, so at every point such kind of stems are created and then that waveform is generated. Similarly we can have a bar graph type of waveform, or we can have histogram or stairs kind of waveform using some other commands. Now next is the use of if else statement in MATLAB, right? So this if else is generally used whenever we want to test some condition, and if that condition is true we are going to do something, and if that condition is false then we are going to do some other thing, right? So using this if else we can have decision making. So here an example is there, that is x is equal to 2.5. So this is the value assigned to the variable x, and here if statement is used. Now while using this if statement we have to write this if, and inside round brackets we have to write the condition that we want to test. Okay, so here x less than equal to 0. So if this is condition is true then this statement will be executed, that is y is equal to 1, right? Otherwise it will go to this else. Now inside this else again we have written instead of else, else if, right? So again some condition will be checked. If this condition is true then this y2 will be equal to 2, it will be assigned the value 2. If again this condition is also not true then it will execute this else statement. Now in this the y variable will be assigned a value 3. And finally we have to write or end the if statement using end keyword. Now we'll see the demonstration of this. So now let us say x equal to 2.5. if x less than equal to 0, y equal to 1, else if x greater than 0 and x less than 3, then y equal to 2, else y equal to 3. Then finally we have to write end. So I have to save it, and when I execute this code I will get here the value of y equal to 2, because this condition is satisfied, that is x should be greater than 0 and it should be less than 3, only then this will be true. So here the value of x is 2.5, so that's why this statement gets executed. So in that way you can use if else loop in MATLAB. Then next is the for loop. So whenever we want to do something repeatedly fixed number of times, then in that case we can make use of this for loop. Okay, so in this first case we have example as sum equal to 0, so sum is a variable and in that we have put the value as 0. Then for I equal to 1:1:4, so it means that the starting value of this I variable will be 1 and the final value will be 4, and the intermediate values will have a difference of 1. Then in the inside this for loop we have sum equal to sum plus I. So this for loop will simply add all the values from 1 to 4 and it will store that result in this sum variable. In this second case this structure is called as nested for loop. So we have two for loops, this is the first for loop and this is the second for loop. So here this value of I is going to vary from 1 to 5, and value of j is going to vary from 1 to 3. And inside this for loop, we have written a, I, comma j. So a will be a matrix and I, comma j will be the index positions of that matrix, right? So I indicates row and j indicates column, right? So that will be equal to I minus j. So whatever value will be generated by this difference, that is I minus j, that value will be assigned to the specific element of matrix A. Okay, that will be done in this for loop. Now we'll see the demonstration of this. Now here I will write the first for loop. So let me have sum equal to 0, then for I equal to 1 colon 4, then sum equal to sum plus I. And I will end this for loop. And if I want to display that sum, then I can write here sum. Now if I run this, I will get the value as 10. So this for loop has simply added the numbers from 1 to 4. Okay, then next example, let us say for I equal to 1 colon 4. Again, one more for loop, j equal to 1 colon 5, and I will write here A as the matrix, A I comma j equal to I minus j. Then I will end this for loop and then end another for loop. And now I want to display the matrix, so I will just type here A, right? So now if I run this, I will get a matrix over here, right? So you can see that this is the matrix A, which is having 4 rows and 5 columns, and the values of these elements is decided with the help of this statement, that is the current value of I and j variables. Okay. So this is how we can have nested for loops whenever we want to deal with two dimensional arrays. Then next is the use of switch case statement. So this switch case statement is again used to execute a specific case whenever the value of a variable is specific to that particular case, right? So here an example is there. So we are going to take some input from user. So that input is stored in this variable x. So x is equal to input, and in single inverted quotes, enter a number between 1 to 3. So this message will be prompted in the command window. So after that, user has to enter some number. Okay. So in the program, we are going to use switch x. So x is the variable that in which the number entered by user will be stored. Then that number is checked using these cases. So case 1, if that number is 1, then you can display the message as you entered 1. Then if that number is 2, then you can enter display this message as you entered 2. Similarly for 3. And if the user has entered any number other than 1 to 3, then you should have some message like you entered invalid number, right? So this is the last case that is called as otherwise. So if none of these above cases is satisfied, then whatever we have written in this otherwise case, that will get executed. Okay, so now we'll see the demonstration of this. So let us say x equal to input, in single inverted quotes, enter a number between 1 to 3. Then here I can use switch x case 1 disp you entered 1. Then case 2, again I will copy this, you entered 2. Case 3, you entered 3. And the last case is otherwise, you entered invalid number. And finally, you have to end that switch case using end statement. So now if I run this, you'll see here a message is displayed in the command window, enter a number between 1 to 3. So now I will enter 1. So it will display the message as you entered 1, right? So if I again run it, and let's say now I enter the number 7 and hit enter, then it will give me the message as you entered invalid number. So this is how I can make use of switch case statement in MATLAB. So now the next one is use of functions. So function is used whenever we are going to execute some part of code again and again. So instead of writing those statements in the main program, we can write those functions inside a function, and we can just call that function in our main program. So this will help to reduce the memory requirement for storing the program. So now here one example is there. Here we are having one variable x is equal to 0.5, and here this is the call to the function. So we are having some function with the name as function 1, okay, and this x is the input argument for that function. So this x value will be supplied as an input to this function, and this function is going to generate some output, and that output is stored in this variable y1. Now this is called as calling the function. Now here the function is actually defined, okay. So here function is a keyword, okay, and after that we have to write inside square brackets the output argument of that function, means whatever output that function is going to return, that we have to write inside these square brackets, and after that equal to the name of the function, that is function 1 in this case, and here y1 will be the input variable or input argument for that function, and this is the statement that will be executed when this function is called, that is function 1 is called. So here y2 is equal to y1 into y1. So whatever input variable we have given, that variable will be multiplied with itself and it will be stored in y2, and this y2 value will be returned to the statement where this function was called. So this y1 will have the value present in this y2 variable, okay, and after that we have to write end, which will end the function. So now we'll see the demonstration of this. So let us say x equal to 2, and now here I will have, let's say, y1 equal to function 1. This is the name of the function, and here I have to give the variable as the input. So here x variable is given as input, right? Now here I can define that function. So for that we have to use the keyword function, and then we have to write the name of the function, and then we have to write the output variables that the function is going to generate. So let's say y, okay, equal to, again here I have to write the name of the function, so the name I have taken as function 1. Then here I have to supply the input argument, okay, let's say t. Then I can end this using the end keyword. Now here I can write what will then here I can write what statement I want to execute whenever I call this function, right? So here let me say, use the equation as y equal to a into a, okay, so this a is the input variable, it will be multiplied with itself, and the value will be stored in y. So this is the output variable y, right? So whenever this function is called, at that time this x will be treated as input variable, so the value of x is 2, so this 2 will be given to the variable a, okay, and here 2 into 2 multiplication will take place, so the result is 4, that is stored in y. So this y is nothing but the output variable, and this output variable is again stored in this y1 variable, because we have assigned this function 1 call to the y1 variable. So now if I save this and if I run this, I get the value in y1 as 4. Okay. So this is how we can create functions and use these functions in MATLAB.